Hi, everybody. I'm so glad that we can be together today. Please remember that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you're always welcome to worship with us here at Wilton Congregational Church. I'm Reverend Ann. I'm the senior minister here at WCC, and today in our worship service, you will be hearing from our church school coordinator, Larkin Brown, Deacon Claire Wilson, and our director of music, Eugene Sorotkin, Adam Reed, and others are providing our music for today. As you can see, we record our pieces separately, and Eugene has edited this service together for us, and thank you so much for doing that, Eugene. As you know, we will not be meeting in person for the near future, but we have our regular Zoom Tuesday Bible studies, Friday meditation sessions, along with Zoom opportunities for our children and young people. If you want to be a part of any one of those gatherings, please check your email, and if you don't have a link, just email the church at office@wiltoncongregational.org. We have a special project for each one of you for next week, the 31st. Next Sunday, the 31st, is Pentecost. It's the birthday of the church. In honor of this birthday, we're asking that each of you send in a picture of you and those that you are sheltering with, hopefully wearing something that's a little or maybe a lot red in that picture. If you can get these pictures to Colleen by noon on Thursday, the 28th, we will make your picture part of our birthday celebration service next Sunday, the 31st. And this week, we're starting a new video series in our Zoom Tuesday morning sessions. We will be working from Dallas Willard's book, Hearing God, Developing a Conversational Relationship with God. You can order the book if you wish, but it is not required that you do that in order to be part of the study. If you want to be part of it, just contact me and I will send you the link. I've heard from folks who are interested in joining our church, which is very exciting. So we have scheduled a Zoom new members class for this Wednesday evening. If you're interested, please get in touch with me at ann@wiltoncongregational.org. Please know that you can always continue to support our church financially through electronic and text giving, as well as by mail. The easiest way to give is just to go to our website, www.wiltoncongregational.org, and press the Give button that's in the upper right-hand corner. We appreciate all that you do to help us. We love to hear from you, so please keep in touch and keep us updated with your best email so that we can make sure that you know everything that's going on here in the life of WCC. Let us now worship God together with joy.
Good morning. If we haven't met before, my name is Larkin, and I will be doing today's children's message. God is so powerful. Guys, God is bigger than we could ever imagine. And even with all of this greatness and awesome power, God chooses to love us. God loves us in such a profound and powerful way. God's wish is to put that same great power to work in us and through us. He wants to empower us. To empower means to make somebody stronger and more confident. God made us powerful and brave. When we tell our friends that they did a good job, or when we give them a high five for doing something awesome, we are empowering them. We are making them feel more confident. God gives us the ability to love deeply and spread kindness to others. We have the power to love others just as Jesus did, and we have the power to teach people God's ways. In our stay-at-home Sunday school lesson this week, we are learning about how even as children, we can use our unique skills and talents to point others to Jesus. Before you get started on your stay-at-home Sunday school packet, let's pray together. Dear God, you are a powerful, almighty God. Thank you for empowering us to do great things. Guide us, God, as we continue to grow in your love and share the teachings of your Son, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
The scripture lesson is from the Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 23 in the New Testament Bible. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power in us who believe, according to the working of his great might, which he accomplished in Christ, when he raised him from the dead and made him sit at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he has put all things under his feet, and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Here ends the scripture lesson.
Bow your heads in prayer with me. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations that are in each of our hearts, may they be acceptable in your sight. For you, O Lord, are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This past Thursday was Ascension Day, and one of you sent me a great meme about it. It says, "Tomorrow is the Feast of Ascension. To those who wonder what it's about, it's the day when Jesus started to work from home." I just had to show you that one. I'm still laughing about it. But in honor of Ascension Day and Memorial Day, I have another story. There was this man. He was taking it easy, lying on the grass, looking up at the clouds. He was identifying the shapes that the clouds make when he decided to talk to God. "God," he said, "how long is a million years?" God answered, "In my frame of reference, it's about a minute." The man asked, "God, how much is $1 million? God answered, "To me, it's a penny." The man paused and then said, "God, can I have a penny?" And God answered, "In a minute." I know it's an old joke, but I love that one. I love to tell it because it reminds us of two things that are extraordinary about our God. First, God is all-powerful, and God has unlimited resources. Yet, at the same time, God is close enough to each of us that we can see the signs of God's presence all around us, and we can have conversations with God throughout our day. One God, two manifestations. In theological terms, the all-powerful and limitless aspects of God are called the transcendent aspects. And the God that knows every hair on our head, the God that loves us through and through, the God that comforts us and hears each one of our prayers, represents the immanent aspects of God. It is hard to hold transcendence and immanence together in one being. It is hard to comprehend the amazing majesty alongside the incredible tenderness of God. Often, throughout our spiritual journeys, we tend to think of one aspect of God above the other. But there is one truth about God that ties this together. The truth is that God is in control. Whether it is the totality of the universe or the intimacy of each of our lives, God is in control. It is innate to we human beings that we want to be in control. But when we begin to mature emotionally and spiritually, we realize that our control is limited. Ultimate control belongs to the higher power that we call God. Our scripture for today is part of the first chapter of Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. Ephesus was a thriving city in ancient Asia Minor. It was the home of the Temple of Artemis, which was considered one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. Many traveled to Ephesus to see this temple, to visit the library of Celsus, and to see the open-air theater that could hold 25,000 spectators. Travelers wanted to witness the amazing sights and sounds of Ephesus. It was sophisticated and cosmopolitan. It was Broadway and Wall Street rolled into one. As is usual in the Apostle Paul's letters, he begins by stating the topics that he will expand on later in the letter. It is clear from our passage that the Apostle Paul wanted the young church in Ephesus to internalize two important points. First, Paul wanted the Ephesians to know that God is in control. He says, "I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe him." Imagine what it must have been like for Christians in Ephesus. The economy of their city was dominated by a pagan temple to the goddess of the moon. While their faith gave them hope and joy, the Ephesian church members probably felt fragile and threatened in their daily lives. Paul knew that they needed to hear that their God was a God of immeasurable power, who is far above any ruler or authority or power or leader or anything else. Some years ago in the UK, researchers went door to door asking people about their belief in God. One of their questions was, "Do you believe in a God who intervenes in human history, who changes the course of affairs, who performs miracles, etc.?" When published, their study took its title from the response of one man who was seen as rather typical of those who responded. He answered, "No, I don't believe in that God. I believe in the ordinary God." How many of us believe in just the ordinary God? Like an efficient firefighter, an ordinary God may be good at dousing flames, but that God will not change lives. Paul knew that the Ephesians needed more than just the ordinary God. They, like us, needed a God that can transcend our difficulties and the challenges of our world. A God that brings good out of tragedy, beauty out of ashes, hope out of despair. We all need a God who is in control. But secondly, Paul wanted the Ephesian church to understand their importance in the realm of God. He wanted them and us to know that their contribution in helping the world to become all that God created it to be. Paul says, "I pray for you constantly, asking God, the glorious Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, to give you spiritual wisdom and insight so that you might grow in your knowledge of God." Before we leave Ephesus, let me digress and note that I have been there. Paul and I visited in 2011, And we can attest that it is indeed one of the most spectacular vestiges of the Roman Empire anywhere in the world. But here's the thing. The reason it is so spectacular is because it failed. There is no modern Ephesus. The river silted up, choking off its access to its economic engine, the Aegean Sea. Over time, the people of Ephesus moved on, and we are left with an archaeological treasure and an object lesson on where we should place our faith. In our children's message today, Larkin Brown spoke of the last words of Jesus before he ascended into heaven. "You are my witnesses." This is the mission of the church. We witness to the power and love of God. We do this by witnessing to the hope, peace, and joy that comes from our trust in God. We witness through our words and our actions. We witness through our prayer. In 2008, Christian singer-songwriter Stephen Curtis Chapman and his family suffered a terrible loss. Several years after the tragedy, Chapman wrote a song about he and his family were sustained by prayer during this dark time in their lives. Chapman says that even when his grief was so overwhelming that it was hard to believe in God's promise of hope, he knew that others were believing for him. He knew that he and his family were upheld by prayer. I know from speaking with many of you that you are witnesses to Christ's light in this dark time. Just as Wilton Congregational Church has witnessed to this community for almost 300 years, you now are supporting those who serve. You are upholding those who mourn. You are offering hope to those who suffer. You are believing for those who are not able to believe. This Tuesday, as I mentioned in the announcements, we're starting a new series in Zoom Bible study. It is on Dallas Willard's book, Hearing God, Developing a Conversational Relationship with God. Dallas Willard was a professor of philosophy at the University of Southern California for many years. He is the author of many philosophical books, and he's also well known for his writings and his teaching on Christian spiritual formation. In an interview shortly before his death in 2013, Dr. Willard was asked this pointed question. "When you look at how off track the church is, do you ever just throw up your hands in despair?" Dallas Willard smiled and said, "Never." "But how can you not?" the interviewer prodded. "Because," said Willard, "I know Christ is the head of this church, and Christ knows what he's doing." In a time when our lives have been so turned around that we have to remind ourselves what day it is, I am so proud of the ways that you continue to witness to the hope and power of God. I am so proud of the ways in which you continue to be the church, even when we are not able to gather in person. This week, I encourage each of you, I encourage you to ask God to show you new ways to witness to the love of Jesus Christ, to your friends and your neighbors. Amen. Thank you. Let's begin our time of prayer today with a time of silence, in which each of us offers to God our own silent, private prayers of thanksgiving, of intercession, and of joy. Let us be now in the spirit of prayer. O Lord, we thank you that you hear all of our prayers, those that we pray aloud, those that we write down, those silent prayers that we lift to you, and those prayers that are so deep within our hearts that they have no words. We are so grateful that you hear, you understand, and you are always answering our prayers. We ask that you will give to each of us the eyes, the ears, and the understanding of faith, so that we can see and hear and know your answers that we pray on this day. We come to you with so much upon our hearts, O Lord. First, we thank you for the beauty of the springtime and the work that you are doing in our world and in our lives. We are so grateful that during this dark time, you give us continual signs of your presence with us and your great love for us. Help us to see your signs, O Lord. O God, we know that you are the great healer. We know that you do not always promise a cure, but you always give a healing as we turn to you and open our lives to you. We thank you for your physical, emotional, and spiritual healing. We pray that you will be with Joni Wallace's father as he recovers from surgery. We ask that you will help all who need your healing presence in their lives, O Lord. We pray that you will comfort and strengthen those who mourn the loss of loved ones. Help them to feel your loving arms around them. Today, we remember and we honor those who lost their lives in the defense of our country. Help each of us to live our lives to be worthy of their sacrifice. We pray that you will give to all who are leaders and teachers your guidance and wisdom, O Lord. We are so grateful for the work they do in our church, our town, our state, our nation, and our world. And Lord, we pray that you will be with all who go into danger willingly to protect us. Our police officers, our firefighters, our healthcare professionals, all who serve in our armed forces, protect and guide each one of them. And for each of us, we pray that you will shape us into all that you have created us to be. Guide us during these challenging times. Help us to light the way with the light of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us bow our heads for the benediction. And now go into the world in peace, declaring the praises of God, who has called you out of darkness into wonderful light. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.